All right, so did Matthew actually contradict the Bible by misquoting what he thought was in Jeremiah instead of Zechariah? Let's go back and recheck. You know, it takes some reading and time. Doesn't he know what the difference between Jeremiah and Zechariah is? Really? So we're looking at Zechariah 11, 12 to 13. 11, 12 to 13. What we had done was check out this guy's objection and read what he wrote, and then read where Matthew quoted. But he didn't quote, actually. Zechariah 4, 11, 4 to 12. At the end it says, I took my staff called favor and broke it, and revoking the covenant I had made with all the nations, the northern and southern kingdoms of Israel, it was revoked on that day, and so the afflicted of the flock who were watching me knew it was the word of the Lord. I told them, if you think it best, give me my pay, but if no, keep it. So they, the leaders representing Israel, paid me, Zechariah, 30 pieces of silver. So, they, the people of Israel, Zechariah is saying, paid 30 pieces of silver in order to be rid of this man, whom they recognized as a prophet of God, but did not want to hear and obey the message he was giving from God. Now you're taking a look at this. We looked at what Matthew 7, 27, 9 to 10 says. And 11, 4 to 13. Zechariah 12 to 13 says, I told them, if you think it best, give me my pay, but if no, keep it. So they paid me 30 pieces of silver. And the Lord said to him, throw it to the potter, the handsome price at which they priced me. So I took the 30 pieces of silver and threw them into the house of the Lord to the potter. So, throw it to the potter, the handsome price which they priced me, a sardonic, sarcastic comment on such a sum of money paid to God's chosen man, which is approximately equivalent to what one would pay for a slave. It's hardly the one who betrayed Jesus. It's talking about an idea. I took the 30 pieces of silver and threw them into the house of the Lord, to the potter who worked his trade instead of in the temple grounds, evidently for temple use. So Zechariah took the 30 pieces of silver, the price of getting rid of God's message and God's prophet, and threw them into the house of the Lord, the temple, to the potter who did his work there. Hundreds of years later, Matthew draws on this account in Zechariah with common points of fulfillment involving Judas Iscariot, who would take his 30 pieces of silver likewise, but paid to him to betray our Lord, the price again of getting rid of God's message and God's prophet, the God-man, Jesus Christ. And Judas would throw the money into the temple, the sanctuary where the priests were, just as Zechariah threw his 30 pieces to the potter who has his shop inside the temple grounds. Notice that Matthew's words are not a precise quotation from Zechariah at all, but a commentary. Let the guy say what he's saying. Look at Zechariah 11, 12 to 13. I told him, if you think it best, give me my pay, but if not, keep it. They didn't want to hear his voice. He was a prophet. It wasn't Judas. It wasn't misquoted. He was referred to. Same point of view that the Israelites did not want to hear the message of Zechariah, and people did not want to hear in Jesus' time the message of Jesus. So they, the leaders representing Israel, paid me Zechariah 30 pieces of silver, and the Lord said to me, throw it to the potter, the handsome price at which they priced me. So I took the 30 pieces of silver and threw them into the house of the Lord to the potter. So then Matthew says, then what was spoken by Jeremiah the prophet was fulfilled. They took the 30 silver coins, the price set on him, Jesus, by the price of Israel, by the people of Israel, and they used them to buy the potter's field as the Lord commanded me. The critical part of this passage is the original Greek, which looks like this. And I took the 30 pieces of silver, the price of him was set on, the price on whom they set a price on the sons of Israel, and gave them for the field of the potter according to as directed me, the Lord. Matthew wrote his gospel presuming that his readers would have a good knowledge of Old Testament scripture. The presumption, he does that in a number of places, the presumption of writers of scripture that the readers would be familiar with the context of passages in the Old Testament occurs frequently, both in the Old and the New Testament. Sad to say, people are not familiar enough to do that. As a matter of fact, hardly any kind of sophisticated references like this are made today in the church because people don't even want to open up their Bibles. So considering that Matthew presumes that his readers are familiar with Old Testament scripture, that he does not actually quote Jeremiah or Zechariah verbatim, and then instead he paraphrases and draws a parallel from the writings of the prophets with the life of our Lord years later, that it cannot be concluded that then it cannot be concluded that Matthew is equating what Zechariah or Jeremiah wrote as a literal and detailed fulfillment in the life of the Lord Jesus Christ, but a fulfillment in certain common points of identity. And D.A. Carson writes, states, in both instances referring to the passages in Matthew and Zechariah, Yahweh's shepherd is rejected by the people of Israel and valued at the price of a slave. And in both instances, the money is flung into the temple and ends up purchasing something that pollutes. On the one hand, we have the passage in Zechariah, and on the other hand, the book of Jeremiah provides a lesson which is also very closely related to what author Matthew is saying in Matthew chapter 27. Listen and read. This is what the Lord says, go and buy a clay jar from a potter, and take along some of the elders of the people and of the priests, and go out to the valley of Ben Hinnom, near the entrance of the potsherd gate. There proclaim the words I tell you, and say, hear the words of the Lord, O kings of Judah and people of Jerusalem. This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. Listen, I am going to bring a disaster on this place that will make the ears of everyone who hears of it tingle. For they have forsaken me, and made this a place of foreign gods. They have burned sacrifices in it to gods that neither they nor their fathers nor the kings of Judah ever knew, and they have filled this place with the blood of the innocent. Sound familiar to what happened to Jesus? Point of identity. Similar. They have built the high places of Baal to burn their sons in the fire as offerings to Baal, something I did not command or mention, nor did it enter my mind. So beware, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when people will no longer call this place Topheth or the Valley of Ben Hinnom, but the Valley of Slaughter. In this place I will ruin the plans of Judah and Jerusalem. I will make them fall by the sword before their enemies, at the hands of those who seek their lives, and I will give their carcasses as food to the birds of the air and the beasts of the earth. I will devastate this city and make it an object of scorn. All who pass by will be appalled and will scoff because of all of its wounds. I will make them eat the flesh of their sons and daughters, and they will eat one another's flesh during the stress of the siege imposed on them by the enemies who seek their lives. In verse 10, then break the jar which the Lord told Jeremiah to purchase, which those who go with you are watching. And I say to them, this is what the Lord Almighty says. I will smash this nation and this city, just as this potter's jar is smashed and cannot be repaired. They will bury the dead in Topheth until there is no more room. Topheth is an area in the valley of Hinnom, south of Jerusalem, where children were sometimes sacrificed to the false Ammonite god of Molech. Later, the Assyrian army was destroyed there by God by fire. This is what I will do to this place and to those who live here, declares the Lord. I will make this city like Topheth. And the houses in Jerusalem and those of the kings of Judah will be defiled like this place, Topheth, and all the houses where they are burned incense on the roofs to all the starry hosts. They were star worshippers and poured out drink offerings to other gods. So in Jeremiah 19:1-13, which we just read, Jeremiah is told to purchase a potter's jar and take some elders and priests to the valley of Ben Hinnom, where he was to warn of the destruction of Israel for her sin, illustrated by smashing the jar. A further linguistic link to Matthew 27:9 is innocent blood, Jeremiah 19:4, and the thematic links include renaming a locality associated with potters with the name Valley of Slaughter, denoting violence. The place will henceforth be used as a burial ground as a token of God's judgment. Sound like A.D. 70? Absolutely, when Rome was destroyed Jerusalem. The reference to Jeremiah 19 provides equally telling parallels. The rulers have forsaken Yahweh and made Jerusalem a place of foreign gods. So the day is coming when the valley where the prophecy is given and the potter's jar smashed will be called the Valley of Slaughter, symbolic of the ruin of Judah and Jerusalem in 19:6-7. Similarly, in Matthew, the rejection of Jesus leads to a polluted field, a symbol of death, and the destruction of the nation about to be buried as foreigners. In the light of these relationships between the events surrounding Jesus' death and the two key Old Testament passages to make up Matthew's quotation, what does the evangelist mean by saying the prophecy was fulfilled? Matthew does not need to devise far-fetched explanations for each word and phrase, because in each case he has truly represented the central theme. The verbal differences he introduces in citing the Old Testament are not an embarrassment to him, because he is not claiming that the Old Testament text is a prophecy to be fulfilled by a simple one-on-one pattern. When we find what we find in Matthew, including Matthew 27:9-10, is not identification of the text with an event, but fulfillment of the text in an event. Let's examine the parts of the passage which objectors claim involve a misquotation. Jeremiah 19:4. For they have forsaken me, God, and made this piece a foreign place of foreign gods, and they have burned sacrifices in it to gods that neither they nor their fathers nor the kings of Judah ever knew, and they have filled this place with the blood of the innocent. Zechariah 11:12-13. I told them, if you think it best, give me my pay, but if no, keep it. So they delators representing Israel paid me, Zechariah, 30 pieces of silver. And the Lord said to me, Zechariah, throw it to the potter, the handsome price at which they priced me. So I took the 30 pieces of silver, threw them into the house of the Lord, the temple, to the potter. Now Matthew 27:9-10. Then what was spoken by Jeremiah the prophet was fulfilled. They, the chief priests, the leaders representing Israel, took the 30 silver coins, the price set on him, Christ, by the people of Israel, and they used them to buy the potter's field, as the Lord commanded me, Zechariah. Notice the passage in Matthew does not quote verbatim what Zechariah wrote down, or what Jeremiah wrote for that matter. Instead, it draws on a number of points of identity, a number of parallels with a commentary on what Zechariah and Jeremiah say. Matthew uses the pronoun him in Matthew 27:9 to mean Christ, in order to emphasize a point of identity, which is to identify the prophet and God-man, Jesus Christ, with the prophet Zechariah in the passage in Zechariah, and God in the passage in Jeremiah, and their rejection of God by the nation Israel. The 30 pieces of silver are also brought out as another point of identity. Notice that Matthew uses the pronoun me in 27:10, which cannot refer to Jesus because he was not given the 30 pieces of silver. Judas was. This use of me then must refer to Zechariah, who was commanded to throw the money into the potter's area in the temple, as Judas did years later. Matthew states that Zechariah was ordered to buy the potter's field, something which the chief priest did in Judas's time as well, not Zechariah. And they used them to buy the potter's field. The Lord commanded me, Zechariah. This is Matthew's way of bringing out points of identity. So D.A. Carson states, here, me in Matthew 27:10 can only refer to the prophet Zechariah and not to our Lord. Yet Matthew keeps it, me, even though he changes other parts to him, meaning Christ, because he believes that in obeying the Lord, the prophet, whether Zechariah or Jeremiah, was setting forth typological paradigms, meaning patterns of behavior of individuals pointing to future parallel events in the life of our Lord. Therefore, by this construction, the author Matthew is maintaining not a literal fulfillment in every detail, but a fulfillment in contextual points of identity. As Carson puts it, he, Matthew, believes that in obeying the Lord, the prophet of the Old Testament passage which Matthew referred to, whether Jeremiah or Zechariah, was setting forth typological paradigms, the emphasis is mine, that truly did point to Jesus and the greatest rejection of all. Matthew sees in Jeremiah 19 and Zechariah 11 not merely a number of verbal and thematic parallels to Jesus' portrayal, but a pattern of apostasy and rejection that must find its ultimate fulfillment in the rejection of Jesus, who was cheaply valued, rejected by the Jews, and whose betrayal money was put to a purpose that pointed to the destruction of the nation. Points of identity, and they are typical of Israel's rejection of God's people, and especially Jesus Christ, and the epitome of the rejection. Jeremiah alone is mentioned because he is the more important of the two prophets, and perhaps also because, though Jeremiah 19 is the less obvious reference, it is the more important as to the prophecy of fulfillment. Sometimes you refer to a group of books in the Bible, and you say the prophet Jeremiah. So in Zechariah 11, the buyers, verse 5, and the three shepherds, verses 5, 8, and 17, apparently represent Israel's leaders who are slaughtering the sheep. God commands Zechariah to shepherd the flocks marked for slaughter, and he tries to clean up the leadership by sacking the false shepherds. But he discovers that not only is the leadership corrupt, but the flock detests him. Thus Zechariah comes to understand the Lord's decision to have no more pity on the people of the land. So Zechariah decides to resign, exposing the flock to ravages. Because he has broken the contract, Zechariah cannot claim his pay, presumably from the buyers, but they pay him off with 30 pieces of silver anyway. But now Yahweh tells Zechariah to throw this handsome price at which they priced me, ironic, to the potter in the house of the Lord. So much for that. More on this next time.